Okay. How was everybody? Good. Good. The concept of celebration Sunday is about saying thank you for the salvation that God has given to us, but it doesn't end there. It is actually a way that I could encourage God's people in order to share the gospel. So when you think about the celebration Sunday, we celebrate with the salvation that we have, but it doesn't end there. We should share the salvation that we have to somebody else. Is somebody over here? But anyway, please open your Bible with me, the book of, by the way, those who are leading here, we want to develop people. We don't want those almost, every Sunday you will see the face here in the front. We change that, of course. Those who are leading here, they're actually a Berean Celtics. So next month, I don't know who wants to host the celebration Sunday, because we want to develop people from the South Church all the way to Main Church. Okay? So that we will not just see all the people, they become professional. We don't want that. We want people who have professional in their heart with the Lord. That's the kind of people we want in His church. Please open your Bible with me, the book of 2 Kings. Chapter 7, but we could start actually in chapter 6. Chapter 6, verses 24 to 25. Okay, let me establish here the background of the passage of chapter 7. In chapter 6, verses 24, Lord, is my toy is not working. Okay, it's there. So, in chapter 6, verses 24 to 25, Ben-Hadad, the king of Aram, mobilized his entire army and barricaded the whole city of Samaria. So think about this, because the city is surrounded. I want you to think of this city. This is actually the concept of the old city in the Old Testament time. So, if you look at this picture, the Aramean soldiers, they barricaded or they surrounded the city of Samaria. When you think about being surrounded, it means that this is actually the military strategy in the Old Testament time. So what they will do, they are going to surround or barricade the whole city, and there is no coming in and coming out. You know what will happen? There is no food that will come in. And not only that, little by little, they're going to cut also the water. And eventually the city, what is going to happen to the city? They will surrender to the other king. So here it is. The soldiers, the Aramean soldiers, surrounded the city of Samaria, and now they don't have food to come in. Not just the food. They don't have water and any supply that could come in the city of Samaria. Knowingly, there's no food is coming in, what will happen in the city? There is famine inside the city. And let me show you here. I want you to look at verse 25 in chapter 6. In chapter 6, I want you to look at that. What it says in verse 25? How much they are selling the head of the donkey? Imagine just the head of the donkey. They are selling for 80 shekels of silver, and an equivalent of today's amount is 460. Now that's the US dollar. just for the head of the donkey. Their ceiling is so expensive. Maybe they will eat also the bones because they have nothing to eat. That's how difficult the people inside the city of Samaria. Now, not only that, this is the most difficult I'm going to. When I look at this passage, I could not believe if parents could do this. I want you to look at in verses 28 to 29. Look at carefully what has happened here. They have nothing to eat. Now they turn into what? Oh, cannibalism. They will even eat what? Their own son, just for them to survive. Wow. If you will not eat, but can you take it? You're going to eat your own son. Wow. That's how difficult being in the city of Samaria that is surrounded by the Aramean soldiers. With the situation that they are facing, they are desperate to hear a good news. Hearing a good news, this will change the situation, this will change their circumstances. The first point I'd like to share with you is the good news. The good news that they will receive is coming from individuals that have been what? Rejected by the society. I want you to look at your Bible now in chapter 7, verse 3. I want you to see verse 3. There were what? Four men with leprosy at the entrance of the city gate. Now, why they were in the entrance of the city gate? Because what? Leprosy was considered extremely contagious. They were forced to live outside the city walls, quarantined by the normal society. Their disease forced them to live apart from their wives, children, and there was a social stigma. They were despised and rejected by others because they have this kind of disease. In normal circumstances, these four might have received what? Leftovers from the residents of the city. Not only that, receive what? Spoiled vegetable or any rotten food. Now, I want you to look at in verse 4. I like this conversation between these four leprosy men. And the other leprosy man, he said, "You know what? If we're going to stay here, what? We will die. If we're going also to go to the inner city, what? We will also die. Why not? Let's go to the Aramean camp and we will surrender there. If they will, then we will die. But if not, then we will live." Look at this. I mean, you're just like having a conversation with four individuals that have a cancer. You know what? There's nothing we're going to lose. Anyway, we will all die. Let's do this. Wow. The other leprosy man says, "You know, anyway we will die, then let's go to the Aramean camp." God has chosen these four leprosy men that have been rejected by the society to bring good news of their circumstances. Now it's hard to believe. It's hard to believe that somebody would like to bring, who would bring the good news with somebody who is not good in the eyes of the society. Is that okay? I'm bringing a good news, but the one who is bringing the good news is not that good in the eyes of the society. Now I tell you, it's hard to believe. It's hard to believe. But let me tell you this. If God would use
undignified person, if God would use somebody who is a billionaire, then where would be the honor go to? Where would be the honor, the glory? We'll go to the person who is popular, who has the capability. But I tell you, God used just like you and me. God could use, we are nobody in this society, but God loves to use us in order for us to give glory in His name and to nobody else.
We don't have names in this society. But I tell you, God could use us to bring good news to our society. The second point I'd like to share with you is the good news will come out when we sense of doing what is right for the good of another person. I want you to look at here, look at first in verses 6 to 7. Look at your Bible in verses 6 to 7. So I want you to think, in the Aramean camp, there are maybe 100,000, 500,000 soldiers. In that camp, there's so much food, there is wine, everything is in the camp. And what happened in verses 6 to 7? Come and tell me. What the Aramean soldiers, they heard what they heard? Come on. They heard sounds. What kind of sounds?
Chariots and horses.
Chariots, horses. And what they say? What they say? Oh, the king of Israel, he hired what? An Egyptian armies, the Hittites armies are on the way. And what happened? They ran away from the camp. Here is the four leopards, they're coming in anyway.
They have arrived to their mindset. What?
to share the good news. Because they let go of what is good to them, and they start having a concern to those in the inner city that have been dying because there is no food. The good news that this poor leprosy man will change, will transform the lives of those people inside the city of Samaria. I believe, my friend, you and me, we have the good news. We have the good news. But until we will arrive that we have that sense of doing what is right for the sake of somebody. The last point I'd like to share with you is the good news should not be kept. It should be shared with a sense of urgency. If I have the good news that I discovered the cure of cancer, and I tell you, I will not sleep tonight. Immediately, I will call all the media and announce to them that I discovered the cure of cancer. I want you to look at in verse 9, see it, the last part of verse 9. What he said, if we wait until daylight, the punishment will overtake us. Let's go at once and report this, what? To the royal palace. There is urgency for the poor lepers to share the good news. They could not wait until daylight. They must do it right now. If they will not share the good news, and the king will discover that they are not telling the truth, I tell you, those four lepers will be executed. And that's why they need to share as soon as possible that they have discovered something that would help the circumstances of his people before the sun will come up. The good news is so good that the lepers could not keep it for themselves. The city of Samaria is facing death without food. They are desperate. They're in desperate situation. They will even cook their own son so they have food to eat. Knowing the circumstances, the situation of the city of Samaria will not keep the good news that they have, because the good news, it will change their situation. It will change their circumstances. These four lepers, they have a sense of urgency. They could not wait until daylight. They want to share the good news right now. Look at verse 12. What happened in verse 12? So they went to the doorkeepers of the city, and here is the soldiers. The soldiers met them in the city gate, and they explained what had happened in the Armenian camp. And then in verse 12, what happened in verse 12? The gatekeepers shouted the news. If you look at the following verses, there is a stampede. People are running, going to the foot. Why do we need this truth today? Because we're holding the good news and we have done nothing. In the New Testament, the praise good news had been mentioned how many times? In verses, it's mentioned in 87 verses. Now let me give you here a four verses that I've mentioned about the praise good news. In Mark chapter 1 verse 14, it says, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming what? The good news of God. And then in Mark chapter 1 verse 15, the time has come. He said, the kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe what? The good news. And then in Acts chapter 5 verse 42, day after day in the temple courts, from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming what? The good news that Jesus is the Christ. And the last one,
Then Philip began with the very passage of Scripture and told him what? The good news about Jesus Christ. If God will ask you today, what have you done with the good news that I have given you? I believe you and me has been holding that good news since you believed and received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. But the question now, what have you done with that good news that is in your hands? I would like to challenge each one of you. Let us not keep the good news for our own self. We should be concerned with our loved ones. We should be concerned with our office mates and with our neighbors. The Word of God says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, it says, I tell you, tomorrow is the time of God's salvation. Is it tomorrow? Oh no. I tell you now is the time of God's favor. Now is? Not tomorrow. Not tomorrow. There is a sense of urgency that we could not wait tomorrow because tomorrow it may not come. My friend, I hear lots of testimonies that life in this world is just too short. Maybe you see me now, but I don't know what will happen to me tomorrow. Nobody could say that I am good and I'm okay tomorrow because you are not the one who is holding of your life. My friend, don't keep the good news for your own self, because the good news is not a personal consumption. We need to be concerned with urgency that the people around us, the good news, that they will hear that good news that you are holding, that will change their life, that will change their circumstances. Now sometimes, when you're trying to share, or you're trying to bring the good news to somebody, and it is normal that the person whom you're trying to share the good news, they will not see it, that what you are holding is the good news for him. And that's why in this church we want to develop, we have developed the soul church approach. Because we don't want just you to share the gospel and after that you're done. No, it's not. We want you to be part of the soul church. That after receiving and believing the Lord Jesus Christ, you have a little community that will help you, that you are going to walk with the Lord. And you're going to exercise your spiritual gifts. And you'll be able to experience the one anothering in Christ. My friend, I tell you, believe me, nobody could survive in this world in his Christian life just by yourself alone. You need to be part of the community. And that's the very purpose why we have the self-church approach. We want you to find a little community that who knows what is going on to you personally, that could be a help to you if you are not part of any self-church in our church. I want you to be part of it because you need a community that will help you in your Christian life. You could not survive in our own. When you start to isolate yourself, you could be easily defeated by your enemy. But when you are together, when you pray one another, when you minister to one another, when you love one another, Satan is joking. He was saying, I could not touch this person because he has a last backup. He has a backup of prayer warriors. He has a backup who would encourage him when he is discouraged. But if you are alone, I tell you, our enemy could easily defeat us. Let me conclude with a story. I remember a story of two boys who had been friends together, had been friends for at the very start in their childhood time, they've been together. So they went to the elementary together. They went to high school together. And after that, they went to university together. In reality, they married
two sisters, the older one has been married by the other friend, and the younger one has been married with the other friend. They are just close with, and one day, somebody shared the gospel or the good news of Jesus Christ to the other friend. And the other friend, he believes and received Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And the other friend, he started discerning that somehow he could be able to share the good news of Jesus Christ to his friend. And he kept saying to himself, I'll do this tomorrow. After tomorrow is done, is gone, and he starts saying, I'll do this tomorrow. As you know, the tomorrow will never end. To make the long story short, one day, he called up his friend. Nobody answered the phone. And then he called up the landline. Nobody answered the phone. After a few minutes, he received a call from his wife. Before his wife, he started saying the word, she started crying. His wife said, your friend just died in a plane crash. We keep waiting tomorrow, tomorrow, tomorrow. You don't know what is ahead of us. Maybe we're here today, but tomorrow we are gone. My friend, maybe you have a friend. Maybe you have a neighbor, your office mate. Maybe you have relatives. Don't wait for tomorrow, because tomorrow it might be so short. Now is the time. According to the word of God says, today is the day of salvation. I want you to stand up with me. Please stand. Maybe there is somebody that comes into your mind and you want that person to know the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to pray for that person. And then as you pray, make a plan in your mind that you're going to have a personal appointment with that person before tomorrow comes. Again, I want you to remember that person and come to the Lord and say, Lord, I remember my friend. I remember my office mate. I remember my neighbor. Lord, I want to bring the good news of Jesus Christ to that person. But I don't know how. Father, would you strengthen me? Would you anoint me? Would you empower me that I could speak your word? Father in heaven, we thank you so much, Lord, for allowing us to reflect on what had happened in the city of Samaria when they were surrounded by the Aramean soldiers. There is famine inside the city. They have nothing to eat. And the worst one, they will even sacrifice and cook their own son, that they have something to eat. And Lord, you have used somebody who is nobody in the society in order to bring the good news. And I believe, Father, that your people here in the house of prayer, yes, Lord, we are nobody. Maybe there are person who hurt us. Maybe there are person that we don't like. But Lord, you want us to be your instrument in order to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to that person. Lord, help us to say yes. Father, thank you. Help us, Lord, that we will not So press the good news that you have put in our heart. I pray, Lord, that we have that sense of doing what is right. Help us, Lord, that there is an urgency in our heart to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, thank you so much for your people who are here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please take your seat.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.